imagine the wave function where the ordering of the two particles is like this, and when it is the opposite order, and there is a corresponding scattering factor which we associate to the exchange, which is s of lambda 1 minus lambda 2. In this case, it is s of 0. And it just turns out that in this model, or in these models, this is minus 1. So just like for free fermions. So we would have a situation like free fermions, and we also know that in free fermions, we have a Pauli principle, so two particles cannot occupy the same mode, so to say. I mean, here we don't have free wave functions, so we cannot talk about eigenmodes, so to say. Nevertheless, this property is important and it is satisfied. Actually, we will deal with consequences of this property. Okay? This was a small comment, addition to yesterday. And now I will move on. So now I erase this.
Balázs, may I ask a question, please?
Yeah.
As an initial problem, we can have a fermionic problem or a bosonic problem. How it can reflect on the beta equations and on the beta roots? For instance, for strings, can we say that instead of lines, we'll have some elliptical curves? I don't know, something like that. Can we see the initial fermionic or bosonic structure on the beta roots?
So you mean like having non-interacting bosons or non-interacting fermions?
Yes, yes.
No, I don't understand completely the question. I mean, you can have some... please repeat. I don't understand specifically what you
want. Sorry. I'm trying to ask something maybe strange, but how initial nature of the problem, it's bosonic or fermionic, reflects on the beta roots. Can we say
I cannot say anything really general. What I see in all examples is that, for example, this Pauli principle is always satisfied. Okay. So it doesn't matter whether you start from a fermionic system or you start from a bosonic system. In these integrable models, it seems, well, not always, but almost always satisfied. So for example, if you have a fermionic system, then what you would get is S of 0 is equal 1, but you also have fermionic statistics, so you combine it with this one, and then you get Pauli principle. If you start with bosonic system, then you will get S of 0 is minus 1, and combining with bosonic symmetry, this means that Pauli principle has to be satisfied.
So okay,
it seems to be general, and I don't know a clear distinction, really. I mean, I know that there are some counterexamples, but very isolated counterexamples to this Pauli principle thing. I mean, there is, for example, the spin one integrable Heisenberg chain, integrable XXX Heisenberg chain, which has a specific Hamiltonian. I don't know it by heart. It's not the usual Heisenberg chain. So it has something like SJ plus one squared, and here is some number. I don't remember what number it is. So anyway, it's integrable spin one chain, and it is known that in this case, we can have coinciding abilities for special states, only for very special states. So some counterexamples exist, but in mostly the Pauli principle holds, and on the level of beta roots or pattern of strings, etc., I don't know any clear distinction. So somehow the free bosonic point is very singular, it's very isolated. But we have this linear model, so linear model. You can have a coupling constant C, and as soon as C is non-zero, it turns out that Pauli principle will be satisfied, and you have beta ansatz and with non-coinciding abilities, etc., etc. And only the point C equals zero, which is free bosons, where you can have Bose-Einstein condensate, is very, very special, and it's a singular limit actually for physical quantities. So somehow free bosons are far away from beta ansatz in some sense. You cannot make a small C expansion. This is what I wanted to say. Maybe, I don't know if Andrea will talk about this or not, but really free boson is not a good point to start investigation. Okay?
Okay, nice, thanks.
So, I mean, maybe Andrea will talk about it, I don't know, but in this model, the C equals infinity, not right for some reason. So C goes to infinity. This corresponds to free fermions in the linear model, infinite coupling. And then one usually would do a 1 over C expansion in some senses.
Okay. I will talk a bit.
Okay. So yesterday we learned about beta roots, strings, etc. And today we want to learn a little bit more about beta ansatz in general. And the big question is, why does beta ansatz work? It's a very, very big and very general question. On one hand side, we can say that we did our computations in the last two lectures, and then we really just verified that the beta ansatz is a good solution. I mean, we sat down and we solved it by hand. And you can do it for other models also. But then people started to understand as decades progressed that there must be some kind of algebraic structures behind these theories and some unifying guidelines or properties or ideas which make this solution possible. There has to be something. And indeed, there is something. There are so-called algebraic structures behind it, so-called Young-Baxter equation, which we will actually encounter in the last lecture. But today, I will be talking about higher conserved charges, set of higher conserved charges. And before I move on, actually, let me start with a historic curiosity once again. Historic curiosity is that there is a talk by Richard Feynman, which you know from QED, Feynman diagrams, etc., etc., or also Bethe integral to quantum mechanics. And I will give the link here in the text box. I will not share screen, I just give the link here. It's a talk of Feynman, one of his last talks, I think, maybe even the last talk, I don't know, I'm not completely sure. And then here he talks about quantum field theory in three plus one dimensions, so the generic problem, and with high energy physics, and at the end of the talk there are questions, and the questions include some topic about jet production, like a high energy jet, which is effectively a one-dimensional theory or one plus one-dimensional theory. And just when you download the text, you can see that just at the very end of this lecture or talk or questions, discussion session, he mentions beta ansatz. And I will now read it aloud. You can also check it, but I will read it aloud. Feynman says, "I got really fascinated by these one plus one-dimensional models that are solved by the beta ansatz, and how mysteriously they jump out at you and work, and you don't know why. I am trying to understand all this better." So this was a comment by Feynman. Actually, it is known that he was interested in these models at the end of his career or life. I mean, he was working to understand eight vertex model a little bit better, but then he passed away before. I mean, algebraic solution of these models was really deeper understood. I think solution of eight vertex model was around at the same time as when Baxter, when also Feynman was working on it. So we understand why.
So if Balázs, if I can add just as a historical remark.
Yeah.
I read that after the Feynman death, when they entered in his office, in the blackboard, or maybe you can say, okay.
You just finish. I will look for it.
Yeah, yeah. It's they entered in the office and there was a blackboard with many stuff written in there, and there was a sort of part in which was written things to learn or things to do, and in the list it was written a better answer, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, yes. I mean, just when you were saying this, I found the image. I mean, it was okay. Easy to find you using Google.
Yeah.
I will put here. I mean, I think. I mean, I'm not sure if this is the whole picture or just part of it. You can look, but indeed, to learn beta ansatz is there.
Okay. Yeah.
I also read some other comments about, but I don't remember where. But he was saying that eight vertex model should be possible to be solved using creation annihilation operators or something like this. But it's of a different type eventually. So okay. This was a nice historical comment. And now we go to these higher conserved charges. So what is a higher conserved charge? We have the Hamiltonian. It's an operator, local operator acting on the spin chain, a Hilbert space of the spin chain. It's an extensive operator because we have a summation over an operator density, which is a local operator, two-side operator. Now we will have conserved charges Q of alpha, where alpha is an integer index, such that it is also an extensive operator, so it is given as a sum, or sometimes as an integral over space, J is a side index of the spin chain, and there is an operator density. I write it like this: alpha is same index, and J is position of this operator density. And what we require is that operator density should be a local operator. It should be a short range operator. And then typically you can choose things such that the length of Q alpha, the operator density, can be equal to alpha. I mean, it's just a matter of convention. And then alpha is one, et cetera, one, two, et cetera, three, three. And of course, these charges are only, I mean, all of the charges only exist in infinite volume system. But if you go to finite volume, then a few of these charges can be defined. And the very important property is that as operators, they commute with each other. So Q alpha, Q beta commutator is equal to zero. And also important is that Hamiltonian should be a member of the series. So if I have this kind of normalization, then I can say that Q2 is identified with Hamiltonian, or maybe proportional, I mean, depending on how you define it. Also, typically we require that they should be self-adjoint operators. It's not absolutely necessary. There are some models where it's easier to work with self-adjoint operators, but in order to have real eigenvalues, this is good to define. And it can be satisfied in most cases. Well, this is Q2, but here I start with one. So what is Q1? I mean, in the spin chain, we can identify Q1 to be total as Z operator, so summation over J as Z acting on spin J. It clearly commutes with the Hamiltonian, so this is fine. And then there are the higher conserved charges. And now today I want to discuss two topics, at least in this first lecture, I want to discuss two topics. One topic is how can we construct these conserved charges, or what can we know about them? I mean, this is a long topic and I will not cover everything. I will not cover algebraic gait ansatz. If I have time in the last lecture, maybe I will cover some parts of it, but I will nevertheless show some properties of these charges, at least for the next charge in Heisenberg model. So one topic, how to construct them and what do we know about them? And second topic, or second big question is, what is the consequence of these charges on the dynamics of the model? And how can we argue that existence of these charges leads to beta ansatz in some sense? Well, actually, it does not give you beta ansatz, it gives you this elastic factorized scattering. And beta ansatz is when you go to coordinate space wave functions and then you implement it. So I will argue that if such conserved charges exist, then we have a completely elastic and factorized scattering. And this is the essence behind beta ansatz. And this is what I called in my first lecture, this is what I called two-body reducibility. So somehow conserved charges lead to two-body reducibility. So this is the plan. Right, now I delete it. I want to actually start with Q3. So I erase the general formulas, and I want to construct you the Q3 for Heisenberg spin chain, which would be given as a summation over J, some operator density, which is somehow positioned at site J. And this operator density should span three sites. This is what we expect. I will tell you the answer. So the best, I mean, maybe you want to know how we derive this answer. This is from the algebraic construction, which I will start to introduce in the last lecture. For the moment, I want to have some simple examples so that you can have, I mean, something simple in your head, hand. So that's why I'm starting with something simple, and I give you the solution. So the solution is that the operator density for Q3 is the following. I have an I, it is needed to have self-adjoint operators. And then I have commutator of permutation acting on sites J and J plus one, with permutation acting on sites J plus one and J plus two. So clearly, this operator density spans three sites because it spans J, J plus one and J plus two. And I can have also different form of this operator by working out the products of permutations. This is very simple. And actually, let us do it. It depends on, the whole thing depends on how you want to denote, how you want to denote permutations. Now, I don't want to introduce notations using, I don't know, usual mathematics notation for permutations. I just want to draw diagrams. So I want to draw diagrams. So for example, if I have a site J and J plus one, and if I have a permutation acting on these two sides, then I will draw like this. This means that two sides are permutated, so content of this Hilbert space is translated to here. It's a vice versa. Now, what do we have here? So we have this product minus the product in the other direction. Let us draw the diagram for it. I mean, it's very simple. So here, I mean, in the origin, with the plus sign, we have something like, here is J plus one, and here is J plus two. First, we do permutation here. Then we do permutation here. So, I mean, I can also write this simply as this type, this permutation. So we have J plus one, and J plus two. So it's clear, I think. Now, what do we have if we do it in the other order? If we do it in the other order, then we get first, and let me draw. We get first a permutation acting on these two spaces, and then we get this permutation. So this can be written simply like this, where this is J plus one and J plus two. Clearly, they are two different permutations. So when I take the difference, it is not zero. Commutator is not zero. So what should we now check? I mean, we should check that this operator Q3 commutes with the Hamiltonian. This is one thing. Second thing is we should analyze what this commutation means. Okay. Now, the first thing I want to give as a homework, I will just say a few words and about the strategy. So I really suggest that now you write it down. So this is a homework. I mean, try to prove that Q3 commutes with Hamiltonian. And I will just say a few words about strategy. I mean, either you just figure out how to do it yourself, which is also not very difficult. I mean, you can do it, or then you should shut your ear now, or you can just listen what I find the simplest. For me, the simplest proof is using diagrams. So for me, the simplest proof is write down Hamiltonian or imagine it in our head. Really, this one will not matter because it commutes, it's a scalar. So we only need to take a two-side operator, one more permutation. And then we need to act with Hamiltonian before and after Q3. In Q3, we have these two terms, and we need to act with one more term before this permutations or after these permutations. Now, Hamiltonian is a sum over operators, local operators. This is also sum over local operators. But you can see that many, many terms will actually commute because, I mean, if these three sides are disconnected from the two sides of this operator, then of course it commutes. So the only possibility to have something non-vanishing is when the support of the operator densities just touch each other. So when we have some, for example, this situation or this situation or this, I mean, you can think about it. There are four possibilities. And for each of these.
Yeah. Sorry, but do you hear me well?
Yes.
I was wondering if this vertex diagram in some way reproduce or obey Jan Baxter. Shall I find Jan Baxter with this diagram?
Well, it comes from the Jan Baxter equation. I don't know if I mean directly how to make use of it. This I don't know, but it originates from Jan Baxter equation. So there is the underlying solution of Jan Baxter equation, and then you analyze it, and then you get it.
Oh, this okay. So Jan Baxter is previous to these diagrams.
Yes, but I am not sure if I can discuss the whole algebraic theory. So that's why I chose to give one example. Okay.
Thank you.
And just another question: what is this factor in front of the two permutation operators?
Here it's I.
Ah, okay.
It is for convenience because when you think about it, then you will see that. If I is not there, then it is anti-self-adjoint or something. Because you know, for permutation, the adjoint is just making it backwards. And then when you make it backwards, then I think you just permute a two, which gives you a sign. And then if you have an I, then it will be a self-adjoint operator.
Okay.
So I also sat down and I proved this commutativity by drawing diagrams. And then you can really convince yourself that you just need really the commutator here, the difference. If you just take one specific term and then you compute commutator with high, it is not zero. But then you take this term and this term with an iris clearly, and then commutator with h, then it will work. Okay, so it's homework. I suggest to do it. It does not take more than 10 minutes. So, I mean, maybe it's even less. I don't know. It was not a long computation. You just have to write a couple of diagrams and then you are done. So that's one thing. With this, we established, or at least the homework, those who do the homework, they establish that Q3 commutes with H. Now let us then think a little bit about the meaning of this equation. How can the Q3 operator act on beta states? So we have our beta states. Let us imagine that we have beta states. For simplicity, let us say infinite volume, okay? So some beta states without beta equations, just arbitrary beta roots. Now they are eigenvectors of Hamiltonian via this commutativity. So it must be that they are also eigenvectors of Q3 with some eigenvalue. I will denote it as lambda 3. So this is operator, this is eigenvalue. Really, the eigenvalue has to depend on the beta roots. So the beta roots are lambda 1, etc., lambda n. And now my statement is that the eigenvalue has to be additive in the beta roots. So in the eigenvalue, there cannot be any interaction between the beta roots. My argument is the following. We know that in the beta Ansatz wave function, at least in infinite volume, there are always contributions where the particles are very well separated from each other. And in this separation, I mean, they act as free plane waves. I mean, well, not act, but they are free plane waves. Of course, we have a sum of terms, but in each of these terms, I mean, they are free plane waves just with permuted order. Now, Q3 is a clearly a local operator, a local extensive operator. So operator density is strictly local. So it only acts on those parts when there is a particle. I mean, the action on empty space is identically zero. This is clear because of the commutator. So it only acts on those parts when we have a particle. And if the particles are well separated from each other, then this means that the eigenvalue has to be additive. So it has to have an eigenvalue on a free wave function, and afterwards it has to be additive. This is my argument. So in infinite volume, at least, the eigenvalue should be the following. Lambda 3 has to be of the form, maybe I should write k, it goes from 1 to n. And there should be a function, I denote it as h3 of lambda j, which is the one particle eigenvalue function of evaluated for rapidity lambda j. Now, this argument also holds for every other charge. So now believe me that we can construct these higher charges also going to Q4, Q5, etc. They will become more and more complicated operators using permutation operators. Nevertheless, they are always local, so they can be closed into a small segment of the string chain, which grows, but still it is a local segment. And then using this argument, we can write that generally eigenvalue Q lambda alpha, eigenvalue of Q alpha has to be additive, so it has to be of the form sum or k goes from 1 to n, h alpha of lambda j. And this is an infinite volume. But when you go to this algebraic theory, then you can actually show that the same statement will also hold in finite volume, given that the charge is not too large. So if the charge is fine and it fits into the finite volume, then this such equations will hold with the same eigenvalue functions. So for example, this Q3 charge clearly spans three sides, and so you cannot put it into a volume of two, length two. But you can put it into a volume of length three. I'm not even sure. Is it meaningful there? We should think about it. I think it should be meaningful. I think it will be meaningful. And then these equations should hold. But in finite volume, it's very important that these equations only hold for the so-called on-shell states when the beta roots satisfy beta equations. In infinite volume, we don't have beta equations, so eigenvalue equations like this always hold, irrespective of what the actual values are. In finite volume, they only hold if you satisfy the beta equations. So much about the eigenvalues. And the next question is, we have this very concrete charge. Now, why don't we really just evaluate what is the single particle eigenvalue? So the single particle eigenvalue, I will delete now this. And maybe, sorry, before I go there, maybe I did not completely finish this argument. So, of course, when I write down this eigenvalue, then I use the idea that they commute with the Hamiltonian, because then I know that they will be eigenvectors of the charges also. This means that it is fine to look at the eigenvalue equation in a certain specific configuration, for example, when particles are very well separated from each other. I don't need to care about those cases when particles are close to each other and how Q3 acts on a situation where we have, for example, three particles close to each other. I don't need to care about it because I know that it commutes with the Hamiltonian, so there will be an eigenvalue corresponding to the Bethe state, and then we can just find this eigenvalue by looking at specific components where the particles are separated. Okay, this is the completion of the argument what I was saying here. I think the first time I did not complete the argument. Right. So this was the argument which tells us that eigenvalues should be additive. Now comes the part when we should actually find at least one eigenvalue. So we should find eigenvalue function corresponding to single particle with rapidity lambda. How do we do this? I mean, first of all, we have this e to the I k propagation factor, which was given by lambda over I over 2 over lambda plus I over 2. And then we just take a plane wave. We take a plane wave and we compute how this operator acts on the plane wave. Well, this is very simple. I will not do it in detail. So this is second order. But I mean, this is even easier than the previous one. I mean, this is really, really easy. But you just need to think a little bit what happens. I will write out the final answer, okay? So if I am not mistaken, then the final answer is the following. I need to take I times, okay, I write it down also using, I write it down also using P and also using lambda. I times E of 2IP minus E of minus 2IP minus I times, no, minus 2, sorry, 2I times e to the ip minus e to the minus ip. So this is what you get when you think about it. And if I express it using lambda, then I get minus 2 lambda over lambda squared plus 1 over 4 to the power of 2. So I encourage people to go and try to find out why we have this and this, and then to substitute either by hand or whatever, mathematical or whatever, to get this. I hope I did not make mistakes. I mean, sometimes I can make sign mistakes or something, but I hope it is correct. And out of curiosity, I can write down the relation that H3 of lambda as a function is actually related to the energy function. It is given by the energy derivative with respect to lambda multiplied by minus 2. This minus 2 is irrelevant. It's just a matter of conventions. But it's an important property. I mean, it follows from the algebraic construction that eigenvalue of Q3 is actually the derivative of the Hamiltonian eigenvalue, which was Q2, more or less. I cannot explain it now. This would take, again, one complete lecture to figure out why this holds. But let me just say the answer that we always have that H of alpha plus 1 of lambda is proportional to H of alpha as a function of lambda and taking derivative with respect to lambda. So you go to higher and higher charges, then you take just derivatives of the eigenvalue function. It's just a curious fact which comes from the construction, algebraic construction. And I wanted to say so much about the concrete example. Of course, as I said, we can go to Q4. Then it's a more complicated permutation operator which has permutations acting on four sides. We can go to Q5, but it's meaningless to do it, I mean, by hand. I just wanted to show you one concrete example where you really get a feeling about what is happening. But then all of this is constructed using the algebraic Bethe Ansatz, using transfer matrices, etc. So hopefully we will go there on Friday. But now, what comes next, or what we will do, as I promised, we will analyze the consequences of these charges on the dynamics. So we will analyze what they mean and how they lead to completely elastic factorized category. I will delete it. So far.
Balázs?
Yes.
Excuse me. Perhaps for those who would like some physical interpretation, this operator is actually an energy current of the Hamiltonian.
It is true. It is a peculiar property also of these models. I mean, there are even much more properties, much more symmetry relations. But yes, I mean, maybe later we will go there in more detail. As Leland said, it is correct. It holds generally, I mean, for every integrable model which is comes from Young-Baxter relations, that Q3 is energy current. So current of the energy density under flow generated by Hamilton. All right. One second. So as I promised, now I want to go to completely elastic and factorized scattering. And I will not analyze the Bethe Ansatz wave function. Instead, I will analyze the scattering theory picture. So it is a little bit heuristic. It can be made completely rigorous if we establish exact analytic S matrix theory. But that's a long, long mathematical subject, and I don't want to go there. So all of what I'm saying is can be made very, very rigorous by defining asymptotic states, asymptotic scattering states, and an S matrix, which comes from time evolution of Hamiltonian in long time limit, et cetera, et cetera. But please just be allowing with me so that I can just give the heuristic argument. Heuristic argument will capture the physics behind it, okay? And when I'm speaking about heuristic argument, then I have a semi-classical picture in my mind. So in quantum mechanics, we have uncertainty relations. So clearly, we cannot have position and momentum completely fixed. Nevertheless, I will be talking about wave packets. Today, I will be talking about wave packets also now and also in the next lecture after the break. So imagine wave packets. And with the wave packets, we imagine scattering between particles. And we will imagine scattering between two particles and between three particles. And sometimes it is actually enough to think about classical physics, because the essence is actually the same also in classical physics and quantum mechanics. But when I'm saying quantum mechanics, I will say semi-classical arguments in quantum mechanics. So what is the scattering process? I mean, we are in 1+1 dimensions, so one space and one time. Then a scattering means that two particles are approaching each other, some kind of interaction takes place, and then they also leave each other. So there is particle one, which with incoming momentum p1, there is particle two with incoming momentum p2. Now we want to ask, what is the outcome of the scattering? Now, first very important restriction. We have absolute particle number conservation. Conservation. So we cannot have something like in particle physics, where you collide two protons and all lots of mass flies out. Particle number is also conserved there, but particle minus antiparticle. This is how it works, and then you can have a lot of, thousands of, I don't know how many particles flying out, which is analyzed and served, etc. So here we have particle number conservation in all of our models. This is a very big simplification. Then this means that if two particles collide, then only two particles can leave the collision or scattering event. So the outgoing momenta will be p1 prime and p2 prime. I will just denote it like that. And everybody knows from classical physics what is the only thing which can happen in one dimension. I mean, we have two conservation laws. So we have conservation of total momentum and we have conservation of energy. And these two conservation laws already imply that p1 and p2 has to be either equal to p1, p2 or permutation. But if the particles are indistinguishable, then it means really that nothing happened. So you can imagine in classical physics, two billiard balls collide, and then what was coming from the left will take p2, and what was coming from the right takes p1, and then they go out. Because momentum is conserved, energy is conserved, and generally there is no other possibility of how to keep conservation of two conserved quantities with two particles. And the same argument also holds in quantum mechanics in scattering theory picture, so not only in classical physics. And now we go to three particles and we go to our special models. So actually we can go to generic models also. Let us just make some kind of picture in our head. So let us assume a situation when on the real line we have a scattering event between particles with P1, momentum P1, momentum P2, and I don't know, some momentum P3. I mean, the direction of the momenta is arbitrary. What happens in classical physics? I mean, what happens is depends a lot on the actual two-body potential between the particles. I mean, I can give you one example. I mean, if we have billiard balls, which are completely elastic billiard balls, when they scatter then, or they meet, when they collide, then typically only two of them collide, then we have an elastic collision. And then, for example, momentum P1 is transferred from this particle to this particle, or from this billiard ball to this billiard ball. Then this also meets this one, and then P1 is transferred from the second one to the rightmost billiard ball. So we have, with billiard balls, we have consecutive two-body scatterings. Because of the special nature, that billiard balls have a limited interaction range, they have elastic scattering only when they meet. So that's a special case. However, if you have a generic interaction potential, V of x1 minus x2, and similarly for the other particles, then the outcome of the scattering event will depend a lot on other specific details of the scattering, like what is the relative position on the particles. I mean, this is what we call a three-body problem is in general not analytically solvable. Already in 1D, I mean, the outcome can depend a lot on what is V, what is the incoming relative position between the particles. However, in our special integrable models, we will see that there is a factorized scattering, which is actually has the same properties as with the billiard balls. Billiard balls are just a special case for this, such that eventually the only thing which happens is that the momenta of the particles gets exchanged and we get these scattering phases. I will come to the scattering phases a little bit later, but let us just think a little bit about the momenta, okay? And now we go to quantum mechanics. So we have a scattering event where momenta P1, P2, and P3 play a role because they are momenta of the particles. And then we can imagine that in the scattering event, I mean, this is an incoming state somehow, we will produce a linear combination of terms with P1 prime, P2 prime, and P3 prime. But we have not yet specified what are these. I mean, there can be some coefficients here before that. I mean, this is a generic scattering event. And now we go to our integrable models. And in our integrable models, we already know that we have at least three conservation laws, because total momentum is conserved, total energy is conserved, and total Q3 is conserved. And you can already guess what happens is that typically, in a typical case, these three conservation laws are so much restraining or constraining such that the set of outgoing momenta can only be completely equal to the set of ingoing momenta. Because we write down, I write down that P1 plus P2 plus P3 is equal to P1 prime plus P2 prime plus P3 prime. And then I write down the same for energy. EP3 is equal to EP1 prime plus EP2 prime plus EP3 prime, and I write down the same with this H3 single particle eigenvalue function. And these functions are linearly independent. I mean, we have this derivative relation, but that's a linearly independent function what we get. So this means that, I mean, when you want to solve these algebraic relations, typically algebraic relations, in some appropriate variables, then the only possibility is that this set is equal to this set, and we just have a single coefficient, so single contribution with some coefficient C, which will be the so-called scattering phase. If the relativities are ordered such that this is the leftmost and this kind of going to the right, and this has the biggest speed towards the right, then of course what will happen is that this is exchanged with this one, this is exchanged with this one, also this is, the rest is exchanged, so eventually the ordering will be changed to 1, 2, 3, goes 2, 3, to 1, if we have the correct asymptotic states. So this is already a consequence of what we call integrability, existence of a single conserved charge, which is an additional conserved charge. We also have the other higher charges, and this also, I mean, you can argue that when you go to 4 particles, 5 particles, the same thing happens, you will get completely elastic scattering, just like with billiard balls. So when you look at the outcome, then momenta is not changed. I mean, you can say that there is no momentum transfer on the level of free particles. So something happens, but then when you wait enough, then particles will be separated again, because I mean, we assume they have different speed, and then you can just look at them and read off their momenta, and then you see that there is no momentum transfer. And this is a very, very restrictive physical property, which has very important consequences on transport in these non-equilibrium models. And actually, it can be seen in experiment. So this fact that there is no momentum transfer, in some sense, you can call it like there is no friction. You cannot pass energy to low momentum modes, it seems. It can be seen in experiments. So this is one of the things which makes integrable models special. And this is also one of the things why people are so much interested in them, because of this elastic scattering property and its implications. And I want to go to the factorization to figure out what this factor C is, what is the scattering factor, but I don't know, when did we start? I mean, should I go for break now? Organizers.
We started around few minutes, so maybe we can stop and...
Yes, I think it's good, and then the next lecture I will talk about...
Okay. Do there are questions on this part?
Maybe I have a question, but yeah. Just because I didn't really follow it in the very beginning when you said that the two Bethe roots can't be equal. Maybe you could just explain me that again.
It's a property of the S matrix. So that the S matrix is typically, it's not a constant. So the scattering phase depends on the relativity difference between two particles. But it just turns out that in most models, I think, in all models that I know of, we have the special property that S at 0 is -1. So the S matrix behaves as a free fermionic S matrix when there is no momentum difference. And this means that for this special case, when two particles collide, it is like a free fermion. So this means that we cannot have two particles with the same momentum. In other words, you can look at the Bethe-Ansatz wave function. And then when you look at the Bethe-Ansatz wave function, you want to construct it some over permutations. Then you would need to add this S of 0, and then you will actually encounter something like 1 minus S of 0, which is identically 1 plus, because there is no sign. 1 plus S of 0, which is actually 0, so the wave function will vanish. And it turns out that in most models, it is not possible to have any kind of regularization or anything. This is a statement. I cannot give now you the rigorous proof, but the heuristic argument is this.
Excuse me, can I add a comment?
Yeah.
I think it's possible to define the S matrix to have a bosonic character at zero momentum, because this is called the bosonic formulation of Bethe-Ansatz. Because when you write down the Bethe equations, there is an arbitrariness in taking the logarithm. You have to choose a branch.
Yes.
And there you can choose the branch of the log such that the S metric at zero is 1.
Yes, but then you would get some sign. So the consequence is the same, right?
Yes, for this, yes, but yeah.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Other questions, maybe?
Yeah, so I also have one. Maybe you mentioned this, but so you constructed your third conserved charge Q3. Is it guaranteed to be the only thing supported on three sides which commutes with the H, or?
Please repeat, I just didn't get.
I was asking, so you constructed your third charge, the Q3, which is supported on three sides. Is it guaranteed to be the only independent charge on three sides, or could you? Because if you could construct more, then in principle you could over restrict your problem.
Yes, and this over restriction happens for free theories, I think. I mean, I don't know any general proof of that, it can only be one operator on three sides. When you go to three models, then you can find actually more. And maybe some experts can come up with models that you would have two. I mean, this fact that I was only talking about one comes from this general construction that there is at least one. And in most models, there is only really just one. But I mean, maybe some experts can come up with models. I know that for sure in free models, you can overestimate. But in free models, you have anyways much more degeneracy than in our interacting models.
Okay, thanks.
So let's wait for Balázs.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so I think we got to start if it's okay for everybody. Yeah.
I just noticed that Lorenzo Rossi asked, is it possible to record the lecture? But as far as I know, it's recorded and it's on...
It's being recorded, yes.
It's only already on YouTube. I checked. Previous second lectures are already on YouTube.
Okay.
When you go to GGI, and it's possible to find it very easy. So, where were we? We discussed this completely elastic scattering. But what did we not yet discuss? We did not yet discuss this three factor C, this coefficient, which will be the scattering S matrix. So this is what I will be talking about, what it is. What is the S matrix corresponding to a scattering event, and why is it factorized? So the question is, why do we expect some kind of factorization at all? I will write down three separate situations, and then you can see that this is a very non-trivial property. And now we will talk a little bit in more general terms, assuming for more general models. So where was my pen? So somehow you can imagine an initial situation where it is particle one, particle two, and particle three is well separated from that. So then, if they move towards each other or they have some kind of momentum difference, then if I draw word lines, so this is now time, real time upwards, if I draw word lines, then something like this would happen, that the two scatter on each other, and then, for example, this has a different speed, something like this happens. So in this situation, I mean, this is moving here, this is towards here, and this is moving like this. First, in time, the one and two, they scatter on each other. And if this is very well separated from them at the beginning, then we can expect that the scattering event here is not influenced at all by this particle, its momentum and its position. And then a scattering event happens here between particle one and three, and eventually a scattering event also happens here between two and three. And eventually we get the ordering, as I said before, three, two, and one. Now here, if the particles are very well separated from each other, we see that the scattering matrix should be somehow the product of two body scatterings acting on one and two, particles one and two, then particles one and three, and eventually particles three and two and three. And then if we only have just pure phases, like pure phase factors, like in Heisenberg model, then it's very natural that, I mean, phases just commute because they are numbers. But if there is an internal degree of freedom for the excitations, which we have, for example, for sine Gordon model or the higher dimensional similar models, which we will treat in the last lecture, then it's very non-trivial that the action of the scattering matrices will eventually be the same if you take it in a different order. So what do I mean by different order? We can have a physical situation where we have the same set of incoming momenta, but initially, I mean, they are at a different relative positioning. So for example, we could have that this is moving with some speed towards this direction, this is moving with bigger speed to the left, and this is moving to the right. Now in this case, with the same speed, this scattering is happening first between two particles two and three. I can assume that this scattering is separated from this one, so it's independent. And then eventually there is this scattering happening, and also this scattering happening. So it's a scattering event happening in opposite direction. And opposite ordering, sorry. If it just phases, then we can assume that the product is not assumed, that the product will be the same. But if we have matrices acting on some internal degree of internal degrees of freedom, then it's very not clear that it will be the same. And what's more, even much more not clear is what happens if initially the particles are such that we cannot separate scattering events. I mean, we can have a physical situation where we have particle one here, particle two here, particle three here. Somehow, well, I cannot draw this very well, but we could have a situation where they just meet simultaneously at one point. I mean, clearly we can choose initial separation such that they meet at one point. And then, I mean, what you would say is that the mutual interactions somehow affect each other at the same point. So the effect of the three-body scattering in general should be something different than in these cases, because here we really had a succession of well-separated scattering events. I mean, why would we have the same scattering event if we have three particles at the same point? In generic model, it is not true. I mean, here something completely different will happen. And now comes the argument why we can still have factorized scattering, such that the factorization of the scattering amplitude is completely independent of the ordering of the scattering events. And it's also not sensitive to this situation. It is completely not sensitive. And the argument is, again, not rigorous, but it's a heuristic argument. But this heuristic argument tells you again, I think it tells you the physics behind it. So somehow, the idea is to construct a unitary operation. And unitary operation is actually time evolution generated by Q3. So I take some number tau, which is a real number. It doesn't matter what it is. And I construct e to the tau Q3. So this is a self-adjoint operator. So this is a unitary operation. And then what I want to do, I also look at time evolution of the Hamiltonian operator. Maybe I should put here minus to have the same convention. So real-time evolution of the Hamiltonian operator, this gives you the scattering events. This gives you the scattering matrix, S matrix, in the long time limit. Now, H commutes with Q3. This means that H also commutes with this U. So this means that time evolution operator at any time t is the same as putting e to the I tau Q3 e to the minus I t, no, t h and e to the minus I tau Q3 for any tau, but I choose here tau to have unitary operation. And then what happens is we should investigate the action of this unitary operation on the Hilbert space, but here we are talking about semiclassics. So on the semiclassical situation on the wave packets, what happens? And Q3 is also a local operator such that it gives you individual single particle eigenvalues to the three particles, which depend on momentum. This will mean that under this time evolution, these wave packets also will have some kind of speed. The speed, individual speed of wave packet propagation under this time evolution. And this speed will typically be different for the different particles. It will depend on the momentum of these particles. So this means that this operator is time evolution where they move with some kind of speed, depending on the Q3 operator. So in practice, it means that action of this operator for some tau rearranges the relative position of the particles. Because I act with this is equal to letting some time elapse until they move with some kind of different speed. So not with the physical speed with which they move under time evolution by H, but with a different speed under this imaginary time evolution. And typically this means that we can always choose such a tau such that even these situations can be turned into both this, or these two situations can be turned into each other, so to say. Because we can always choose a tau such that the speeds are chosen, I mean, the speeds are completely determined by the momenta in Q3. And then if the speeds are given, we can always choose a tau such that under this time evolution, somehow the relative ordering will change and this will come closer to this one, or they get separated from each other, etc., etc. And then this event can always be avoided. And this is a heuristic argument. And I think it can be made rigorous, but I have not read a rigorous derivation. There is one paper I know, and also it can be found in Musado's book, I think, references. But for us, I think this is completely enough, this argument, this heuristic argument. And let me say that this heuristic argument also explains us why we can have the Bethe-Ansatz wave function, because what is in the Bethe-Ansatz wave function essentially disfactorized scattering, such that we introduce S-matrix vectors to each particle permutation, but these S-matrix vectors and the whole structure is completely independent of the relative position of the particles, and independent of the rest of the particles. It just depends on two-body exchanges. And this is the reason. And it also explains us why we can have three particles on neighboring positions on the Bethe Ansatz, because somehow even those scattering events should be completely independent of relative positions. So it doesn't matter whether we have three particles very close to each other or very far from each other. And all of this is explained using the charges. And in this argument, you can say that already one charge is enough. So if you want to prove three-body scattering, factorization of three-body scattering, then already one charge is enough. Maybe for higher particle numbers, you need higher charges, but I didn't think about it. Maybe somehow you can even argue that Q3 is enough to have factorization for four particles. I'm not so sure about it. I have not thought about it. In any case, in the models, typically we have an infinite number of higher constant charges. So it's absolutely guaranteed that we have completely elastic and factorized scattering. Okay, are there any questions about this? Otherwise, I will move on and analyze a very important immediate consequence of this elastic scattering. But maybe there are questions, I don't know. Okay, if not, then I will move on. And what I will analyze now is simple two-body scattering. Well, first I will go down to one-body physics again, but I will analyze two-body scattering afterwards. I will analyze the consequence of scattering phases on position of wave packets. This is textbook material, so it can be a little bit boring for those of you who have seen it, but sometimes it is not in the general courses. And in these integrable models, it has special consequences. So I think this time it is good to go over the basic steps again. So what we will consider, wave packets. I don't know how to draw. Propagation of wave packets in single particle case and two particle case. And we will consider Bethe-Ansatz equations and not equations, Bethe-Ansatz wave functions and the effect of scattering on the position of wave packets. What do I have in mind? So I want to have a physical propagation of a wave packet. Because if I just write that, move back to one body problem. If I write that the wave function is actually A of E Px, it's a not normalizable wave function. It extends over all the full space. I mean, it is completely specified in momentum space, but completely unspecified, completely uncertain in position space. So this is not how we think about particles. We think about particles where momentum and position is also a little bit known. Constraint up to Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So what we want to have is actually a linear combination of plane waves such that it is a wave packet. So I write here an integral over dp with some function f of p. The f of p is a Fourier expansion of our wave function. Now, when we do this, then of course, this is not an eigenfunction anymore because we have this summation over the different eigenfunctions. But if you have, if this f of p is well concentrated, it will look like a wave packet which will travel with group velocity. This is standard material. But nevertheless, let us find this group velocity. I know it is standard, but we want to repeat it for two-body case. So how do we find the group velocity? So we need to propagate this wave function in time. Then we get c of x t. And as we do this, then it becomes integral over dp. F of p and then a to the minus I energy as a function of p there t plus e p x. And now what I want to look at wave packets where f of p is centered, closely centered around some special momentum, I don't know, p star. And then what I want to do, this integral will be concentrated in a region that p minus p star is somehow small. Then what I can do is I expand this one part of the energy function around this, and then I just write that e of p I approximate with e of p star plus e derivative with respect to p multiplied by p minus p star. And then what I do is sometimes called the stationary phase approximation, but I've been arguing in a different way. Well, it's the same eventually. So I substitute it and I say this is integral over dp. I write f of p, and then I write e to the minus I. How should I do it? I want to separate terms. So I will write here e prime p multiplied by t, and then I will also write plus e p. Then I separated these terms a little bit. What else? No. Again, I'm making mistakes. So here is x. This is multiplied by p minus p star. And then separately, I have e to the minus I e of p star t plus ai of p star x. I hope it is correct, right? I mean, I didn't make now mistakes. I just substituted this. So this is integral in the relative small coordinate. And now you can see that integration of this is completely, well, this vector does not depend on p. So I can pull this vector out of the integral, it just gives you a phase. It just gives you a phase, and the overall phase is irrelevant in quantum mechanics, at least in one particular case, but there is no relative phases. It doesn't matter. So the only thing what matters is this one. And then from this one, we can read off. Okay, so I made mistakes again. What is the mistake? I factors are not good, sorry.
Sorry, Balázs, sorry. Epsilon prime is calculated in P star, correct? In the expansion.
Huh?
Epsilon prime is calculated.
Yes, in yes, yes. Yes, thank you. And I factors are simply wrong. So what I wanted to write is plus I, then this is not there, and here it is a minus. Sorry, I hope it is correct this way. And then we can see that somehow this Fourier transform is somehow the Fourier transform of this object where we evaluated that x tilde is equal to x minus, because of this minus e prime p times t. And then this also tells us that the wave packet will travel with this speed. So the wave packet will travel with x from x goes to x plus e prime p t. So we read off that there is a loop velocity. I write it like this, or simply I can just write V for simplicity. Loop velocity is d over dt. Single particle wave packet. I mean, this is very basic. I wanted to repeat it. I wanted to repeat it so that we can go to two body case. So we remember what this is. And I did it a little bit, and we go to two body problem. So. Actually, we want to go to two-body problem in Bethe ansatz, because I want to show you what the scattering phase means on the Bethe ansatz wave function. Actually, on a two-body level, we can say that this works for any model, also non-integrable models, because they can be still solved. It's only at three particles where Bethe ansatz comes into picture. But anyway, let us think about that this is already the Bethe ansatz. So originally, our wave function is the following. We have x1, x2. And then we had two terms, right? E to the I.
Balázs, sorry. I think there is a question. Someone raised the hand. There was a raised the hand in the chat, but okay, maybe it's solved. Okay.
I'd like to ask for you to repeat the argument. About connecting the extra conserved charges and the factorized scattering.
Well, is it possible to go back to this at the end?
Okay, I'll stay for discussion.
Yeah, thank you.
Let's keep it for the discussion.
Maybe now I want to finish this. Okay.
Yeah.
So. We have two terms in the wave function. This is one term, and then we also have I will write out using momenta. So not repeating things. Now it's more convenient with momenta. E to the I p2x1 plus p1x2. So this is a nice wave function in infinite volume, but P1 and P2 are arbitrary real numbers, what we choose. Let us now focus on real amplitudes that not the strings. So I want to have scattering where we have individual one particles so that it's real numbers. And now I want to look at this wave function where I take wave packets again. So I do something similar as before. I allow for a generic Fourier transformation where actually I can have two Fourier components, well, two Fourier variables somehow, P1 and modes, P1 and P2, and I multiply by I didn't leave enough space, but f of p1 p2, which is somehow a wave function in Fourier space somehow, or some kind of amplitude. So again, in this case, it is not an eigenfunction anymore because we have linear combination of different momenta, it has different energies, but then we can propagate this in time, and let us write it down, because then we will learn something. What I will also do, I will also write that s of P1, P2 is equal to e to the I delta P1, P2, where delta is so-called scattering phase. If this is both real, then it's a real number. So psi of x1, x2, and t is equal to integral dp1, dp2. I still have the same fp1, p2. This is not changed. It is like this, sorry. You should have corrected me. Now, what do I have? It's very important. The energy corresponding to this time evolution does not depend specifically on the ordering of the two momenta. This we know from the Bethe Ansatz. So it will be a factor which is somehow completely separate. So I will write down the energy factor afterwards. So it's a little bit, it looks trivial, but I will write it down. It's not trivial, but it looks trivial at the moment. I just write down the same thing, e to the I, p2 x1 plus p1 x2. I will substitute this one more later. And then I write e to the minus I, t times e to the I of p1 plus e of p2. So these are the two single particle energies. We propagated the wave function in time because we know that in infinite volume, these are the energies and we have the linear combination. Now, what we want to read off is the effect of this factor on the wave function and on the wave packets. Because if we look at this factor, then we understand that this factor is really just a product of two plane waves. And maybe it is connected to each other, this F Fourier coefficient. But we can also think that maybe it is a product of separate Fourier wave functions. In any case, I mean, when we look at this one and this one, we combine it, then we do the same kind of expansion. So we expand P1 around P star, and we expand P2 around P2 star with some small changes. And then we get the same thing that somehow this will describe wave packet propagation when P1 is propagating around X1. With speed v1 is equal to di over dp evaluated at p1. And similarly, we will see that p2, the wave packet corresponding to p2, if you choose this well, then the wave packet corresponding to particle 2, it will propagate around x2, which is bigger, so this is to the right, and this will have speed clearly di over dp evaluated at p2. I mean, this is very basic, but what do we get here? I will not repeat the whole computation because, I mean, you can figure it out. The only thing which matters is that we have to make an expansion around these points of this function also. Because, you know, we are expanding energy function, P1 around P1 star, P2 around P2 star. And to get the whole contribution, we should also expand the S. So we should expand this delta. So I write that I approximate delta of P1, P2. I approximate it in this wave packet approximation as delta at P1 star and P2 star plus derivative with respect to first variable of delta multiplied by evaluated at these points multiplied by P1 minus P1 star plus derivative with respect to second variable of delta multiplied by P2 minus P2 star. So I substitute these terms into here. I replace S with e to the I delta, where I take these terms. And then I take the same argument as before. And then I collect all the terms which depend on P1 minus P1 star. So what were the terms? I mean, clearly there is a term corresponding to AI, well, proportional to IX. From here, there is a term corresponding to minus IT E prime. And from here, well, from here, there will be a term proportional to, derivative with respect to first variable of delta. And then this is multiplied in the exponent, this is multiplied by P1 minus P1 star. And again, you can argue with Fourier transform or stationary phase approximation that we need to take this into account. I is also present here. So I can be taken out. And then what I find, that for this term in the wave function, the coordinate, so to say, the semi-classical coordinate corresponding to particle one will be actually what? It's important also that this is x2, because I, for p1, I am expanding around x2. So the coordinate for p1 will be x2 plus t times e prime evaluated at p1. And here, if I do the signs correctly and I think about the Fourier transform and stationary phase approximation, I will get actually minus derivative with respect to first variable delta evaluated at, again, p1 star, p2 star. Okay, this should be also p1 star if you wish. So it's the center of the wave packet in momentum space. So what did we get here? We see that we have particle propagation of p1 with the same speed, but it is now propagating around x2, so the coordinate which is to the right. So we interpreted that like a scattering event has taken place. But we have a shift. We have a shift in position, and this shift does not depend on t. It is a constant shift. So this is a shift which is an additive shift with respect to the original propagation. So I can draw verb lines, but let me also take into account now what happens with P2. So for P2, we get something similar. We get x1 plus t multiplied by e prime at P2 star, and then I get actually minus derivative with respect to second variable of delta evaluated at P1 star, P2 star. And now let me draw a verb line diagram of what happens. I will delete this one. So somehow the interpretation of this is that we have incoming wave, this is the outgoing wave, and in the outgoing wave, there is a displacement. So if I draw verb lines, for example, something like this happens, that there is particle one, particle two incoming, there is a scattering event, and as an effect of scattering event, there is a displacement. This displacement is somehow the difference between these trajectories in X. Because if there is no scattering, then one particle one just goes on, but now there is this displacement. And also there is a displacement for particle two. And the two displacements are generally not equal. Depending on some situation, center of mass frame, etc., it can be equal, but generally it's not equal. So these two are generally not equal. And also what is important, that this displacement can be altogether negative, or it can be altogether positive. And we have time, so let us evaluate this displacement in the Heisenberg spin chain. So somehow I should save the formula in order not to forget it. I will erase now this one. So I just copy the formula before I forget. So the delta x for particle with momentum p1 is equal to, I will write it like this, okay, minus derivative of delta p1 p2 with respect to first variable. And this means the derivative with respect to t. And for the second variable, the second particle, the displacement is minus the derivative with now. Derivative with respect to second variable, delta p1, p2. And we can make some simplification when we go to Heisenberg spin chain. I leave this, I erase this. And we should also think about the sign, and then it will turn out whether I made a mistake or not. We can figure out. It's one of those cases when the sign actually matters, and you need to find a good answer. So in Heisenberg's tension, what we had is, you remember that as a function of rapidities, S was of difference form. So this also means that as a function of rapidities, we have delta is of difference form. But now here I take derivative with respect to momentum. So it should be exchanged. And obviously I need to do chain rule. So I need to take minus derivative of delta with respect to lambda one over derivative of p1 with respect to lambda one. Now for a second variable, I need to do the same. So minus derivative of delta with respect to lambda two over derivative of p2 with respect to lambda two. And now I use the fact that this is of symmetry, this is a difference form. So for generally delta at any lambda, I define that the derivative is a kernel function. It is called kernel because it comes up in integral equations later. With var phi, we denote kernel function, which is derivative of this function with respect to its variable lambda. And we take difference form. Now, if we take difference form, then this becomes, here we have derivative with respect to first variable. So this is minus phi of lambda one minus lambda two over, well, I write it like this, dp p1 over d lambda one. Here, what do I get? Here I take derivative with respect to second variable, but it is of difference form, it just gives a sign. So this is plus phi of lambda one minus lambda two divided by d p2 over d lambda two. And already now you can see that, now you can see the reason why typically the displacements are different, because I divide by a different factor. The numerator is the same, denominator is different. So they have, in some cases, this can be equal to this one, and then they have different sign. So we have something like a center of mass frame, for example. But generally, they are different. And then what I need to do, I need to do and compute the actual value of these displacements for the XXX spin chain. And what I want to see is it a positive or is it negative? And what does it have to do with typical properties of the potential, so to say, potential energy term in some sense. So let give me some time. I want to do it. It's an important thing, I think. So for Heisenberg's,
The notation delta is delta top left is delta x1. That's the shift in x1, right?
In my first notation, it becomes x2 because this is x1, x2, and this is x1, x2.
Okay.
After scattering.
Yeah, okay. Because they are both delta x, so I got confused.
Yes, but I didn't want to make complicated notations about this. So even also before and after scattering, x1 is to the left, x2 is to the right.
Okay.
But it is a displacement of particle one, and this is displacement of particle two.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
So what are the functions in XXX model? Just let us really compute it. S matrix, so e to the I delta was delta plus one I over delta minus I. Now let us then take this delta derivative. So phi function, which is delta derivative, is actually the same as minus I times derivative with respect to variable of log of this function. Let us compute it and let us not make a mistake, okay? So minus I, now from this I get one over lambda plus one I, from this I get one over lambda minus I with a minus sign because it's in the denominator. Now I get, I make a common denominator, then I get lambda squared plus one. Upstairs I will get minus two I, and all together I will get minus two. I hope it's correct. So what is this object? What we divide it? So this object is comes from e to the ip, which was lambda minus I over 2 over lambda plus I over 2. Very similar to this one. Sign is different, and we have this 1 over 2. And now I remember, so we will have that dp over d lambda is almost the same, but small difference is that this is plus 1 over lambda squared plus 1 over 4. I hope it is really correct. Now this means that the change for particle 1, so this object, so the change for particle 1, didn't want to complicate notations, is equal to minus times minus, it cancels, so there is 2, there is, I divide by this, so it becomes lambda squared plus 1 over 4 over lambda squared plus 1. Ah, sorry, I mix up lambdas. So this is lambda 1, 2, and this was lambda 1. It's a two different. I'm making too many jumps. So lambda 1 minus lambda 2 squared plus 1. This is a displacement of first particle, and we get the sign. So the sign is that it is positive. So in our semi-classical picture, what did we have? We have particle 1 is approaching from the left. Clearly, it has to have a positive speed, or at least more positive than this one. So we can imagine the simplest situations when this is moving to the left. And it's also possible that they move to the same direction. This is faster and it overtakes. One important thing is that we should have a scattering event so they do not move into other directions. So we have a scattering event. And in the scattering event, the displacement of this is positive. So it is just like I drew it. So it is in the positive direction. Now, does this mean attractive, or does this mean repulsive interaction in terms of classical physical ideas? I mean, if we would be sitting in a lecture room, then I would ask the audience, but it's a good thing to think about physics, like classical physics. Maybe somebody can say from the audience, I don't know. Is it attractive or repulsive interaction when this is positive? Think about classical physics when there would be a potential between the two. Some potential with non-zero interaction length. So any kind like a Coulomb interaction or something, I don't know, maybe that's pointless in 1D, but something similar. Would it be attractive or repulsive if you would see a positive displacement?
Repulsive.
And why do you say this?
Because it's positive. And so it means that it's like jumping backwards somehow.
But in this figure, it jumps not backwards, what I'm seeing. So we have a situation when this is moving to the right, this is moving to the left, and then the position that this gains is a positive. So it was going like here originally. It without interaction, it would go like this, but there was interaction, so it is going like this. So I'm not saying this is jumping backwards. I mean, this is jumping in the same direction, no?
Yeah, okay, so it's the opposite.
Yes, it is attractive. And you can understand that this is an attractive interaction in terms of classical physics or semi-classics, because, I mean, when you think about, now we have a spin chain, but let us forget spin chain, think about classical physics. We have two particles, they approach each other. If it is an attractive potential, then typically it's negative, so they attract each other. They have a bigger speed when they are close to each other. Now they pass each other, they still have a bigger speed. And when they are far away, then they gain their original speed. So this means that compared to the free propagation, there was a time when it was moving faster, so there should be a positive displacement. So with this, we obtained that anti-ferromagnetic XXX chain, actually also ferromagnetic, it doesn't matter in this sense when we really work it out, is attractive. Attractive. And this is completely in agreement with the fact that we have strings, because a string is a bound state of two free particles, and also strings on bound states can only exist for attractive interactions. So we are in agreement with our previous observations. And let me just say that this was nice. This was the This was the spin change, but if you go to the Liebeniger model, which is treated by Yanda Trombettoni, we will see that for C bigger zero, it is repulsive. So we will get a function which is of different sign, it will be negative, but for C smaller than zero, it is also attractive. You can do the same computation. I'm not saying it is homework because it is just too easy. But you take the S matrix, what I had in the previous lecture, or what also Andrea Trombettoni will mention, and then you compute this and you will see this. It's also an agreement with string formation. So here we don't have strings, and here we have strings of arbitrary length.
A naive question, please. In the XXX model that we consider, there is no free parameter to tune. So why it become attractive? Why it's not repulsive?
I mean, so the fact that you don't have a free parameter doesn't tell you anything about the interaction. I mean, if you work out, I mean, there are multiple ways of how you can look at this Hamiltonian, but now I'm using this SU2 invariant form, but you can work with Hopping operators or fermionic operators. So you can really just view this Hamiltonian in a free fermionic language when there is a coupling between fermions. I mean, it's possible to write it like in Jordan-Wigner transformation if you really want. So you can use spin lowering and spin raising operators and rewrite it using fermionic operators. It's an interacting fermionic theory if you really want in another language. And then you see that it has a coupling constant. But this coupling constant is completely fixed by this form, so it's not tunable. But there is also the XXZ model where it is tunable, and then you can go actually from attractive to repulsive regime by tuning the delta parameter. And also there is a free case is the XX model when this delta parameter is zero. Is it a good answer?
Yes. Thanks.
Oh, okay. And we have like maybe 5 minutes of this lecture, and it's just enough to finally point out what I wanted. So I will erase this. This was so far, again, it is textbook material. So this displacement, or sometimes it's called time delay, this is a property of any kind of two-body scattering. I mean, it was actually, it has a Hungarian relation. Because it was worked out, as far as I know, it was worked out first by Wigner and one of his, Eugene Wigner, an Hungarian Jenő, and one of his PhD students. I can look up the precise paper, I don't remember, but this idea of time delay in two-body scattering was worked out by them.
Actually, in his paper, he gives credit to his student, right? If you read the paper, Wigner gives credit to the student, although the student is not an author of the paper.
Ah, okay. Thank you for this. Yeah, I think I remember, and this gives a problem always when we cite things. But what can we cite? I mean, just that paper. All right. So we had two-body scattering, and we had this displacement for two-body scattering. But we also have factorized scattering. So if we have three particles, then what we have is like figures like this, that we have three particles, 1, 2, and 3, and then they just scatter on each other. And so far, we discussed two-body scattering, and we also discussed that a three-body scattering is a succession of two-body scatterings. And now in the semi-classical language, it is very easy to work out what it means. In the semi-classical language, it means that whenever two particles collide, there is this displacement, which is characteristic to the two-body scattering, but these displacements just accumulate over time because the scattering factors, the S-matrix factors, are independent from each other, and all together the resulting scattering factor is just a product of individual two-body scattering factors. So it is a little bit difficult to draw, but I want to draw a picture for this. This was what I had earlier, but now I want to draw the semi-classical picture arising from the scattering, and then you will see what I want. So, for example, we have incoming particles like here, 1 and 2. Now there is the scattering, and there is a little bit of displacement. I mean, not full-time displacement. Now there comes, then there comes particle E, which also takes, it should have be a different, different slope. Well, I'm really not good with drawing, but I'm trying my best. Particle 3, and there is also a scattering event here, also with the same sign of displacement, and eventually 3 will also meet with 2. I mean, now they meet here, and it will also lead to a displacement. And eventually, we have a complete reordering of the particles, so this will be 3, 2, and 1. But you can see that the scattering displacement, they just accumulate. So this was the original orbit, so to say, without scattering. Now, the slope should be the same. I don't know why I made mistakes. So, and then this would be the slope of particle one after just one scattering. But eventually, this is the verd line of particle one after 2 scatterings. And you see that the displacements just added up. So it means that if particles move and scatter on each other in the semi-classical pictures, the displacements just add up. And this is an important property. And actually, this has consequences for the transport. It has 3 consequences of transport. First consequence is what I mentioned before. There is no momentum transfer. So there is each scattering is elastic. Momenta of particles are, so to say, not changed. Rapidities. Second consequence is that if we look at wave packets, in this semi-classical picture, these wavelengths add up, and we can compute them additively. And now comes a very interesting observation of this, which is somehow it gives the basis of a recent theory called the generalized hydrodynamics, which is from 2016. It's a very active area even today, which is, well, even today I'm saying, like only 4 or 5 years old. It's very actively investigated. It's a remarkable theory. It describes transport in these integrable models. It is remarkable that it was only discovered developed in 2016. And one of the key ideas behind generalized hydrodynamics is this semi-classical picture. People can argue that there are different derivations of generalized hydrodynamics. I do not go there. I just mentioned this semi-classical picture. And this tells us that the displacements accumulate. And this also means that if you imagine a situation, a physical situation, when there are many particles in the system, like there is particle 2, particle 3, also particle 4, particle 5, and you look at the orbit of this particle 1, then it will scatter on particle 2, particle 3, particle 4, particle 5, but there is always somehow an average time it travels with its own speed until there is a scattering, until there is a displacement. So these displacements are not separated from each other in time. There is an average, what is this called, free length or free time traveling between another scattering. This also tells us that there will be an average speed of this particle, average semi-classical propagation speed of this particle, which is different from its original speed. So the slope of this line is its original speed, but somehow I can draw another slope, maybe like this, which is the slope following the displacements also. And I imagine that there will be other particles coming here, which also give a contribution to these displacements, and they modify the speed. And I don't have time to go into details about that because I want to talk about other properties of Bethe Ansatz. Let me just say that there is a so-called effective velocity. This effective velocity is computed from these displacements, and it depends on the density of the other particles which are there in the system, and it also depends on the individual rapidities of the other particles. So it is a collective phenomenon. So called Drest velocity is a collective thing which depends on the sea of particles which are there in the system. Maybe we will discuss a little bit of this in the next lecture, depending on how much time we have. Not much, maybe a little bit. And that was it for today. Thank you.
Thank you, Balázs.